The English alphabet is broken, and it's about time that we fix it. Oh, you're still here. Okay. I take it my just stating the obvious fact isn't really good enough, and you'd like me to provide some more information, some examples, and maybe a proposed solution as to how and why the English alphabet is broken and how we could fix it. Does that sound about right? Okay. Well, fortunately for you, I will be doing just that. I have quite a few pages here that I prepared of some notes, several pages, many pages, actually, where I will be talking about why it needs to be fixed, briefly talk about how old it is, and then go into some of the examples of the letters themselves that are broken, how they can often have different sounds associated with them based on how they're used, how there are some sounds that don't have letters associated with them, and then at the end, provide a brief example of some existing words and how they might look based on a potentially new alphabet. And of course, snacks and refreshments will be served at the very end. Now, before we get into all that, a couple of things I want to say. First off, I know this format here, this particular video, not the most ideal way to go about something like this. I should probably be doing something with some fancy graphics to keep it visually attention-grabbing, to captivate you, entertain you, while getting my point across at the same time, and to create a much shorter video. Unfortunately, that's not really my MO, and it's not that important of an issue for me to put all that time and effort into. Ideally, you know, I should be doing this in front of an audience, but my wife and I are parents to a young child who is still in school, and I have that family responsibility, and family to me is the most important thing, and I'm not just going to go up and leave family and my, you know, those responsibilities and financial responsibilities to go on some kind of national tour to talk about how important it is and we must change the English alphabet right away as soon as possible, okay? This is something that's been on my mind over the past year, something that was introduced to me, just the concept of how absurd the English alphabet is by a comedian by the name of Gallagher, the guy that used to smash the watermelons on stage. He did a skit about the English language and the alphabet. It was really well done. And that kind of opened my eyes, you know, to that fact of the English alphabet being broken. And this whole idea, this notion, is nothing new. Now, I'm just adding my voice to the idea that already exists out there, that it's broken and it needs to be revised and fixed in some way. There are some individuals out there, I don't really have the list of names, that have suggested or proposed some reform. Like I said, I just want to add my voice, and this is something that's been on my mind. I just need to get it out and do it in a way as if we were just having a casual conversation. All right, well, with that, we are going to get started with this whole notion of things being broken and fixed. And why is that? So let's start with that. So, first off, you'll have to forgive the way I'm writing on here, the angle that I'm at. It might be a little crooked, but I'll try to keep it as straight as possible. So, Perfection does not exist. There is no such thing as perfection. We live in an imperfect universe. Nature and the natural world are imperfect. And we humans, a product of nature and the universe, are imperfect. Ergo, anything we create is going to be imperfect. That means there are going to be problems and things will need to be repaired, whether it's a political or economic system, our roads, our buildings, our computers and software, and specifically for the subject matter at hand in this video, our language, more specifically, the English alphabet. So because there is no such thing as perfection, this means that there is always and will always be room for improvement. That's why we are here and why society is as it exists today. The different things that we've created and improved upon. And the English alphabet is no different. The grammar, language, even down to our very own personal lives. Now, we can't really improve upon our physical nature too much. Well, maybe exercise. You can improve certain things like your sugar levels, your weight, things like that. So there's that kind of improvement. But when it comes to the structure, the bones and things like that, our vision, some of those things can't be improved upon. But our own personal philosophies, our mindsets, our behaviors, most importantly, we can, in some cases, barring any physical or mental health issues, many cases we can improve upon those less than perfect, those imperfect things about ourselves. So this is very important just to keep in mind all the time, no matter what it is. Perfection does not exist, and there's always room for improvement. That is the rough estimate as to how old the current 26 letters of the alphabet are. 500 years old. Now, as far as living here in the United States, the English alphabet is as old as, maybe going back to when we first settled and colonized the United States. Oh, and before we go any further, I forgot to mention in the beginning of the video that I never went to college. I'm not a professor or an educator at all. I'm just an average human being, so to speak. I have a lot of different interests. I'm somewhat analytical minded, and I can find the flaws in things. And that's pretty much what I'm kind of doing here, is pointing out the flaws and the imperfection and saying, hey, this is broke. Now, how can we fix it? I have my basic idea. There are smarter people out there, probably have a better way of fixing it. So the English alphabet, the 26 letters, as far as being a citizen of the United States, it's as old as however it was first taught here in the United States. But overall, in general, I believe it's about 500 years old, although it's quite a couple thousand years old, technically, when you go back and to where it was first created and how it was borrowed from the Greeks and whatnot. Now, when we talk about things not being perfect and improving and reform and revising things, is there anything that you would do day after day the same way for 500 years? I don't know about you, but there isn't a day that goes by in my life when I'm not reflecting upon the choices that I make, the decisions that I've made, and my behavior, and my own mindset and personal philosophy. And I'm always somewhat deconstructing and reconstructing. myself, I guess, if you will. So when it comes to the English alphabet, the fact that it has not changed for about 500 years old, that's kind of alarming. There isn't anything that we should be doing for 500 years or 100 years or 10 years consistently over and over without improving upon it. Just take a look at software, the operating systems, constantly improving those. Our political system or political systems, we're trying to introduce new laws to create more equality, things like that. So almost every aspect of our lives, the way we build our houses, while that hasn't changed too much, the products that we might use to build them, even at the workplace, when you do your job a certain way, eventually you're going to see that it can be improved upon and done a better, more efficient way. Well, the English alphabet and language and grammar should be no different. We shouldn't stick to the same thing for 500 years. That's ridiculous. And that's why I say it's about time that we fix the English alphabet. That is the root core of speaking English. If we want to address the problems with the English language and grammar, we need to start with the core, and that is all the letters of the current English alphabet. So, from my simple perspective, these are different ways in which I believe that the English alphabet should be or should function and operate. It should be efficient. We should use the least amount of letters to form the words and represent the sounds that we make. It should be logical. It should make sense. It should be reasonable. It should be uniform and consistent, meaning if one letter is going to represent one sound, that is how that one letter should be associated with that sound every time it's used. The letter should never represent another sound, and sounds shouldn't be represented by different letters or multiple combinations of letters. It should lack redundancy. The letter ball, B-A-L-L. Why are there two L's? L makes the L sound on its own. There's no need for two L's. That's redundant. And simple and straightforward. I don't know about you, but when I want to get from point A to point B, I like to travel in the most direct route as possible. When I'm trying to show someone how to do something or talk to someone about something, I like to try to be as brief and concise as possible. Difficult for me when talking about certain subjects. I can go off on tangents. But if I'm showing you or teaching you something, it's this, this, and this, simple, straightforward, as much as possible. Now, there are certain exceptions, like when it comes to, you know, building a home, you know, architecture and things like that. Even then, I think there's probably some very simple and straightforward ways of doing things. The English alphabet, in my opinion, should be no different. Simple and straightforward. Not a lot of rules. Like I before E, except when used in words like neighbor and way. It's just a lot of things that just aren't logical and reasonable and just don't make sense when it comes to the English language and the alphabet. So if you ask me, these are some of the things that we should keep in mind when doing almost anything. Are the actions, behaviors, and the things that we do they stand up to logic and reason? So. So this kind of goes back to what I was saying earlier in the video, as far as it's about time that we change and fix the English alphabet. It's about 500 years old. You know, our own personal lives, a lot of us, a lot of folks reflect and think about the actions and the decisions that they've made and try to avoid making the same mistakes twice and things like that. So, you know, this doesn't just apply to the English alphabet, but we should always reflect on the things that we do and we create and think, put some thought into things. Did we make the right decision? How could we have done, how can we do things better? Review, kind of the same thing, you know, look at what we've done and review it and, you know, think about it. Make the necessary revisions and changes to whatever it is, behavior, building a home, a computer, a video game, or a program, operating system, a car. And of course, reform kind of goes with revise and change. Just, you know, reform it. We do that with our politics. Now, probably the biggest problem with almost anything is the human nature when it comes to the C word, change. We all know, I mean, I do at least, how change of environment, change of a job, etc., can be very nerve-wracking. You know, a lot of people can get set in their ways and they don't want to change. When it comes to the English alphabet, there could be some conservative mindsets that don't want to change anything because it could impact published material that has been written in the past. And if we're going to change the alphabet or introduce new letters, how does that impact what's already been published? And I don't really have an answer for that. But change, as much as we might not like it, it's necessary. And it happens all the time, even with our own bodies. We're constantly undergoing change. So change, we should be embracing it, as difficult and challenging as it may be. We should always be up for the task, and it should never be fear of change, should never impede things that need to be revised and reformed. When you look at the English alphabet, what do you see? Letters. But what are those letters actually? Symbols. Shapes. Straight lines, curves, etc. They are symbols that are supposed to represent an individual sound, for the most part. When you teach a child how to say the letter B, you say it makes the B sound, right? But yet we say it as though it's the letter B. We add E to it. So there's some inconsistency there. And I want to talk more about that when we get into, in just a moment, some of the letters of the alphabet. So they're just symbols. And just because they've been created to look this way, we can change them. We can change them to look like anything we want. Put dots over them. Maybe you want to change the letter C to look like that, the letter D to add a line above it, the letter I, you know, it could be anything. It could have a circle. And okay. But I'm not here to propose a drastic change to the English alphabet to where it looks like something completely new. When we get to the end of the video, I actually just want to propose maybe some new additions to the alphabet. But anyway, they're just symbols and shapes. That's what they are. And we can change them just like anything. Our political system, economic system, the way we make our houses, the way we behave, the way we interact with one another and communicate. Everything can be changed. Not only is there no such thing as imperfection, and things can always and will always have room for improvement and can be improved upon, but things can be subject to change. And we should also keep that in mind. Maybe not necessarily drastic changes, but again, we should just review, reflect, and think about what types of changes that might make sense, hold up to logic and reason, are simple and straightforward, etc. And so the English alphabet, it's just a bunch of shapes and symbols, just like any other alphabet. And the other thing is, just because the English alphabet or our homes or our roads or our political system is a certain way, doesn't mean it's set in stone. Doesn't mean that's how it should always be. No, that's the wrong mentality to have. I like to think that we are progressive-minded, some of us are not, but I like to be progressive in the terms of my own behavior and actions and the things that I do. Again, reflect, review, think about what we can do to change and improve upon ourselves and the things that we create. And again, the English alphabet and the symbols that the letters are should be no exception. So the last topic that I want to discuss before I get into some of the individual letters in just a moment is being consistent across the board when it comes to the individual letters of the alphabet and the sounds and the one sound that each letter should represent, in my opinion. I have here, just for example, letter S, the letter C, and the letter O. And at the bottom, I've written, an apple is always an apple, never an orange. So, take the letter S. When you tell someone or teach someone this curved symbol, you say it's the letter S. Not the letter S. We put this E-H sound, eh, in front of a lot of the letters. S, L, N, etc. Instead of saying this symbol is the letter S. So we should be teaching that this symbol, the letter S, as we currently say it when we try to teach it to someone, should now be changed to it is the letter S, because that is how you say it in most cases. Like the word cars, you don't say cars, you say cars. Like glass, you don't say glass, you say glass. Of course, there is some redundancy in the word glass. There's two S's, which not necessary. S makes the S sound, so only one S is needed in the word glass. The letter C, going to be getting into that letter in just a moment. Should it have the C sound, or should it have the hard K-like K sound? If you ask me, this shape, the letter C, as we currently teach it, should possibly be K, and maybe we get rid of the letter K. I don't know, okay? But this symbol, the letter C as we know it, should represent one sound, like how it's used in the word car, that hard K sound. So perhaps this letter, this shape, this symbol, should no longer be the letter C, because that sound, C, that's actually two words. S-E-E, as in I can see things, and S-E-A, as in a body of water. So, kind of strange, and that's another example of being inconsistent. Now, same thing with the use of the letter O. Now, one consistent thing about this oval shape is that it represents the sound O. It's not E-O, like S. We're not putting anything in front of the sound. It's just one single sound, O. So there's consistency there in how we teach what that symbol is. It is the letter O, one sound, O. So it's consistent in how it's used in words like no and go, but the word T-O, that's not toe, it's to. So all of a sudden, the O takes on a new sound. That is not consistent, nor is it logical, and all that like I talked about earlier. And this last statement is just something that I kind of came up with. I don't know if anybody else has said it before, but an apple is always an apple. It's never an orange or a lemon. So like the letter O, when you have the word T-O, that's two. But if we're trying to be consistent, that really should be toe. But what's happening is the letter O, an apple, for example, in that situation becomes an orange. Okay, so that's just illogical. Doesn't make any sense, right? So we need to be consistent. I'm going to repeat that a little bit as we talk about some of the individual letters now. All right, I'm going to be jumping around from different letters. I'm not going to go through every letter of the alphabet. It won't be here for hours. So I thought we'd start off with this shape. Again, this symbol, these diagonal lines put together to represent the sound wuh. But what do we say that symbol is, or that letter is? We say it's W. So in order to say this letter, in order to say one of the core simple letters of the alphabet of the language, you have to know how to say these other letters. W. How does that even make any sense? This should be the letter W. 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 However you want to say it. We'd have to get into some discussion as to whether it should sound like W or W. And if we need two letters for each of those types of sounds, because you really just can't make a W sound without that or W. You see how there's that slight change? But in any case, the letter W in most cases has the W sound, as in water, where, when, and then of course there's some inconsistency in the word who. All of a sudden, you're not pronouncing the W or the W sound. You're just kind of ignoring it and saying the H sound. And then O is not O. So technically, the word who, if we are to pronounce each of these symbols based on the phonetic or the phoneme that they should represent, the unique sound, W, H, and O, that should be the word W-h-o. But instead, it's who. It's the h sound of h, which is fine. That's consistent. And then o all of a sudden becomes oo. Again, the apple becomes an orange. So the first matter is that we should stop teaching this symbol, that shape, as the letter W. That's just no. Okay, it's the letter W. You teach O that way. You don't say O is car sandwich. No, you say O is O, the way it sounds. Well, the same thing with this. Letter W, it should be W, as it's used in the various words. Okay, the next letter of the alphabet that needs to be fixed is the letter, as we say it, or these two vertical lines with a line in the middle, which looks like a bed, is the letter H. So how do we say this symbol? We don't say it, we don't teach it as the letter H. as how it's often used, we teach it by saying it's the letter H. Again, that doesn't make any sense. So let's get rid of that. And from now on, we start saying it's the letter H. Now, again, there's that little bit of unsurety when it comes to, do you say that letter as H or he? And there's that slight change there with a, you know, H-I-H. Sometimes it sounds like that. Sometimes it sounds like H-U-H. Those are just kind of like the phonetic representations, if you will, of how you would say H. So we have H at. If this is the letter H, then why aren't you saying H at? No, we're saying hat. So then the letter H should no longer be taught as H, but it's the letter H. So again, it's not H at, it's not H air, it's not H om, it's hat, hair, and home. Okay? Now, again, I know we could go over every letter of the alphabet, and there's a lot of other examples that I'm not providing here. When it comes to each letter, like H or O, you know, different ways it might sound or it's used, etc., that might not make any sense or are illogical, but I don't want to spend an hour on each letter, okay? So I'm just using some real basic examples here. The next letter of the English alphabet that needs to be fixed is this shape, that symbol, kind of a opened O, the letter as we currently teach it, C. And again, the inconsistency is when you need to say what that letter is or how to teach it by using these other words, C as in S-E-E or C as in S-E-A. But then, when you go to use this letter, and this is one of the reasons why the English language is probably one of the hardest languages to learn because of all these various inconsistencies and illogical aspects. When you go to use this letter that you have been taught, is the letter C, which is a different word, two different words, you're actually now using it to make a hard K sound, like the letter K, as in car. But then it gets more interesting when you put an H behind the C. And now that combination becomes sh. That's a whole separate other sound. Should be represented by one symbol, one letter, which I'm going to get into after some more of the individual letters. So we have the word champagne. C and H all of a sudden becomes sh. Then we have the word chair. C and H in that situation becomes ch. And that's another sound which should have its own symbol in the alphabet. So more inconsistencies, not just the way we teach how to say what that letter of the alphabet is, but again, you know, the sound that it makes. Now, we also have a word like brace. All of a sudden, the letter C, which also makes the K sound, now makes the S sound like the letter S. Or, one of my favorites, circle. We have one symbol used twice in the same word, and it has two different sounds. How is that even logical? If this word is supposed to be pronounced as circle, then the beginning letter should be S, not C. And if it's supposed to be spelled circle, as it is currently, then there should be some consistency in how that letter is pronounced in that word. So it should be kirkle or circle. Again, an apple is always an apple. It's never an orange. You don't put an apple and a pineapple and a lemon and another apple and then say it's apple, pineapple, lemon, strawberry for that second apple. No, it's always an apple wherever you put that apple. The same with the letter C. It should always represent one sound, whether S or K. Right? Someone has to make the determination on what sound it should make. And if it's going to make the K sound, then the letter K, which makes the K sound, should either represent another sound or not be used anymore. But again, consistency. This symbol, this shape, should be one sound in every situation, in every word. All right, the next suspect is the letter A. Now, we do have some consistency with some of the vowels, O and A. A, like O, and like E, this symbol, two diagonal lines, one in the middle, represents one sound, A, okay? Unfortunately, this symbol is not consistent depending upon how it's used. We have the long A sound as in hay. Then we have the, I guess you say, the soft sound as in hat, a. So we have A, we have a. And then we have the sound when it's used in a word like what. So we have one symbol making at least three sounds. I'm not sure if there's any other ways off the top of my head that might sound, but just for starters, we have three different sounds, A, A, and A, represented by one symbol, and that's not logical. So this symbol, which is the uppercase A, and I'm going to get into uppercase and lowercase once I get through some more of the letters and a couple of the sounds that don't have any letters associated with them. This uppercase A, we have to determine what sound it's going to represent. Is it going to be A? Is it going to be A? Or is it going to be A? It shouldn't change sounds based on the type of word it's in. That's not logical. Now, when it comes to redundancy, like I touched on in the beginning of this video, here's a redundancy right here for you. Hey, if A is already making the long A sound, then we don't need a Y at the end. Now, I know that also looks like the word ha, so maybe what we do is in that case, that a sound is represented by another symbol by putting two dots over the A, which I know that's done phonetically. I'm not sure if that's exactly the phonetic counterpart for the ah sound, but I'm just saying, in this example, if we want to say the word ha, then we would say H plus whatever the symbol or letter is for the ah sound. And if we want to say hey, not hey, how are you, we have this combination, EY, which also has the A sound. That doesn't make any sense. So we have to think about how we change that word. So there are a lot of different aspects and technicalities when it comes to how we're going to improve the English language. But again, we need a way to be consistent, uniform, and something that just is simple and makes sense. Right, we shouldn't have H-A-Y and H-E-Y and then W-E-I-G-H all having that one sound A. It's confusing, and that's probably what makes the English language problematic for people to learn. The next letter we're going to talk about is the letter O. And we say that letter phonetically as OH, O. And that sound is used in words like no, go, and so. So far we have some consistency on how that letter, that symbol, that circle represents one sound, O. And we have words where that letter appears that represents that sound. But now here comes the absurdity and the inconsistency. G-O-N-E, gone. Now the apple, the letter O, has turned into a pineapple. It went from sounding like O in no, go, and so, to sounding like aw. A-W. Now it's taken on a completely different sound. So if you want the O in G-O-N-E to sound like aw, then change that to maybe two dots above it, or you know, a little curvature. I believe there is a phonetic way of representing the O in that situation. It might be the two dots over the O. I don't really know. Again, I'm not an expert on the phonetics. But maybe we introduce the phonetic symbol into the English alphabet. Now, we shouldn't have to go to a dictionary. We shouldn't have a secret decoder ring, phonetics, to know how to say that word. It should be obvious. It should be simple and straightforward. How you say it? By looking at those letters, not by going to a dictionary and seeing a whole bunch of other symbols. Now, if you think that was inconsistent, let's make things even more complicated, shall we? The word L-A-W-N, lawn. So there we have the A-W making the aw sound, just like the O in gone. So again, more inconsistency, not very logical, doesn't make sense. I know this is not the letter O, but I'm just using this example that we have two other letters that represent two other different sounds when combined become aw. Technically, this word, if we are to say this word based on how each symbol represents its own sound, this should be la-e-wun, la-e-wun, or la-e-w-n. Remember, we're teaching this symbol is W. Of course, we never say W ever. We say W. So, lay-wun. No, we say lawn. So if it's supposed to be pronounced lawn, then it should be L, whatever symbol for the aw sound, and then N for the N sound, lawn. And that's just kind of one of the examples that I'll be discussing on how to maybe possibly improve or change the alphabet and introduce new letters, possibly change the words that we used to know. Now we have another example of some inconsistency. The word two. Now we're putting the O, again, an apple is always an apple. So we're putting the same symbol back to back. So when you look at that, knowing how these letters represent one sound, you would think, oh, that's the word to-o. No, it's to-oo. All of a sudden, o-o equals the oo sound, or e-w is probably better, e-w. That doesn't make any sense either. So if you want this word to sound like two, well, you get rid of the W and you introduce whatever letter is supposed to represent the oo sound, because oo, that sounds like one sound. That doesn't really sound like multiple sounds put together. like ch, air. Ooh, that's one sound. So it should have one symbol representing it in the alphabet. So maybe it's E with the two dots over it, whatever you want it to be, okay? But that is the letter O and some of the illogical inconsistencies that are found in its use. Okay, the last letter I'm going to talk about, and there's a whole bunch that I've kind of prepared, but again, to prevent this video from being 3 hours long, is this symbol, the two diagonal lines, which represents, when taught, the sound X or E-H-K-S. However you would like to spell it out phonetically. In order to say this symbol, you have to know how to say the other sounds, E-K, S, which are three other letters. So this symbol is taught as the letter X. That's three sounds you made to represent the sound that that symbol is supposed to represent. And the sound that this symbol represents sometimes is also represented by another symbol, the last letter in the English alphabet, the letter Z, as in xylophone. We also have X-ray, and we have the number 6. So what unique sound is represented by this symbol? I don't think there is a unique sound represented by that symbol. To say X-ray, you have to know how to say E, K, and S, and those are represented by the current letters of the alphabet, E, K, and S. To say this word, xylophone, well, you have to know how to pronounce this letter, Z. So how does that make any sense? So if you want this word to be xylophone, get rid of the X and put a Z there. Let's be logical about this, okay? Simple, straightforward. So maybe this symbol, we need to rethink about what sound it's supposed to represent. Now, I don't have all the different uses of the letter X and all the different words it might be in, but those are the main examples of how the letter X is used. And that's going to conclude analyzing and discussing each individual letter. Now I'm going to move into two sounds that don't have any letter representation in the alphabet. Let's talk about the OO sound, which you would phonetically, well, somewhat phonetically, spell it out by using EW. And here's all the different ways the inconsistent and absurd and illogical ways in which that sound is represented in different words. We have the word two, the word glue, shoe, through, new, menu, loo, and caribou. I don't know if there's any more examples of the OO sound, but these are some of the ones that I found and thought about. So we have OO makes the OO sound. We have UE making the OO sound. We have OE. We have OUGH. We have EW. We have just U at the end. We have IEU. And we have OU. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, five, six, seven, eight different ways and letter combinations that make the oo sound. How is that logical? It doesn't make any sense. So again, we have to come up with one letter in the English alphabet that is going to represent the oo sound. Is it going to be two O's? No, because just the O, that symbol, makes the O sound. So we're going to change T-O-O to whatever it needs to sound like to make that oo sound. U-E, that's inconsistent and redundant. There's no need for those two letters, for an apple and orange to come together and all of a sudden become a new type of fruit. No, that U makes the oo or u sound. Again, we need to have that discussion. Then we have the E. Technically, if we're going to look at that and pronounce it the way those letters each represent a certain sound, then this actually is glooey. This would be shoey. This would be tra-o-g. And na-e-w. And ma-en-u. La-i-u. So you can see we don't currently say them that way, but it just doesn't make sense for all these different combinations to represent that one sound. That one sound should be represented by one symbol. Okay, the last sound that I'm going to talk about is the sh sound. That's one sound. It's not like car, where you can hear multiple sounds, a difference in sounds. Shh. That sounds like one sound, doesn't it? Like s, sh. Okay? So the sh sound is usually represented by sh, which is just illogical and somewhat redundant. We shouldn't have two letters representing one sound. But let's break down the different combinations and more inconsistency and absurdity on how this one sound is represented by different letter combinations. So we have wish, we have motion, we have champagne, ocean, sugar, and then redundancy, more absurdity, lack of logic. Two S's together become sh. But then if you think about it, in the word G-L-A-S-S, glass, the two S's make the s sound. You see? There's no consistency. Two S's here make this sound, but two S's in that word make the sh sound. So, again, one sound, sh, needs to be represented by one letter in the English alphabet. I don't know what that letter should be. Maybe the letter X. Since the letter X is making the Z sound and the X sound that E, K, and S make should represent the SH sound. So wish would become W-I-X. Motion would become M-O-X-O-N. Champagne would become X, A-M. Ocean would become O-X-N. Sugar, X. Passion, X. Again, I'm not saying that the sh sound should be represented by X, but it does need one letter to represent it. And you just see all the different ways, the different letter combinations that make the sh sound. How is that logical? How does it make any sense for T and I of, you know, T-I-O-N to make the sh sound? Those letters are supposed to represent one unique sound, consistent across the board every time they're used. This should be mo'otion, technically, but no, it becomes a whole other creature. Okay, so this is the part where I propose possibly new letters for the sounds that don't have any letters currently associated with them, or I should say a single letter. So let's just call this new letters. So we need some new letters for the, or a new letter for the oo sound, for the aw sound, as in lawn or gone, the ch sound, which is currently represented by combination of C and H, the sh sound, the th sound. That's one sound represented by TH, like that. That should have one letter associated with it, that sound. And the sound. That is one individual sound. It should have one letter associated with it. The letter U, which is often used to make the sound, also makes the long U sound. There's no need for that. One letter, we gotta be consistent. One letter for each sound. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 sounds, and there's probably a lot more. But those are just some of them off the top of my head. That should have letters to represent them. And therefore, we would increase the 26 letters of the alphabet to 32, at least, to include letters that represent those sounds. Okay, the last little topic I want to talk about is upper and lower case. Now, I don't want to get into too much discussion about this, whether it's necessary, but let's just take a look at what we have here. We have upper and lower case symbols to represent certain sounds, right? This is the letter A. A is one sound. The letter B makes the B sound, okay, and so on and so forth. But yet, in some instances, the letter, whether it's upper or lower case, remains the same shape, the same symbol. The letter C looks the same, whether upper or lower case. The letter O, the letter Z. But it gets a little irrational when it comes to the letter Q. You have a small circle with a little hook shape, little tail, but the uppercase becomes an O with a line through it. That's not consistent. Why not just make the lowercase q a smaller version of the uppercase? So q becomes like that. The letter A, why does uppercase and lowercase look completely different? Why not either make lowercase a the same as uppercase, or lowercase and uppercase both look the same as lowercase? So that's more inconsistency. And it doesn't make much sense. If the symbol is supposed to represent one sound, then the symbol should look the same. It should be consistent. Look at this, Q. Two completely different shapes and symbols to represent one sound. So, uppercase and lowercase needs to be addressed. I don't know if we need to get rid of just the uppercase and lowercase altogether, but at least, in the very least, make each letter between upper and lowercase look the same. Okay, for sake of argument, let's just say, ideally, all of a sudden, we've come up with a new alphabet. So let's take some of the existing words as we spell them today and apply this new mindset to them, okay? Let's take the word apple. Let's say that for all intents and purposes, like I said, we fixed the English alphabet, no more redundancy, simple, straightforward. This symbol, the lowercase letter A, now represents the A sound, and a totally different symbol represents the long A sound. We have P, which represents the P sound. We have L, which represents the L sound. And then we have E, which represents the long E sound, or the E sound. So if we are to apply this new type of logic that I've kind of discussed here in this video, and which may have been discussed by other folks looking to reform the alphabet, let's apply this new logic. So apple, the current spelling, that now becomes archaic, and we now spell it A-P-L. Apple. Apple. Three letters. That's it. That is the new spelling. Should we start to spell things the way we say them? Let's be consistent. Let's be logical. Okay? Simple, straightforward. Apple. There you go. No two P's. That doesn't make any sense. If you're putting two P's in there, then you should actually, technically, be pronouncing apple like apple. And with the E at the end, it should be apple-y. But you're not. You're not even pronouncing the E, you're just saying apple. And you're stopping before you get to the E. Another example, the word look at this hot mess. The word scissors. There's a lot of other words that are a disaster. Laughter, daughter. But look at this. S-C-I-S-S-O-R-S. You're not even pronouncing the C. Right? Instead of saying scissors, or the O makes the O sound, so it really technically should be scissors. Or if the I is supposed to be long I, always, remember, consistent, maybe it should be skysors. But no, we say scissors. We don't even pronounce the C. And then we have two S's, which is redundant. There's no need for two S's. Why not just put another S in the beginning, another S there? Why not three S's, four S's here in the middle, and five S's? You know, it just doesn't make any sense. One S is all that's needed to make the S sound. So again, based on the logic and the way we say things, to be simple, straightforward, scissors now becomes S-I-Z-R-Z. S-I-Z-R-Z. Scissors. There you have it. Five letters instead of 2, 4, 6, 8. Simple and straightforward. Okay? Do one more example. Laughter. L-A-U-G-H-T-E-R. There's too many unnecessary letters in there to make the sound laughter. Laughter. Five sounds are made. So, represent it by five letters. L-A-F-T-R. No more of this E-R. That's the er sound. There's no need to put an E in front of that. Otherwise, this should be la-u-g-t-r. No, that's not how you're saying it. You're saying it this way. Laughter. L-A-F-T-R. So that is the logic, if you ask me, that should be applied when coming up with this new language. So again, thank you very much for watching, for however little or long that you did. I hope you got something out of it. Again, just my perspective, just want to add my voice to the voices out there that might be looking to change the alphabet as well. And who knows, maybe cross our fingers and we might have some real change to the English alphabet, to the English language and grammar itself, because there is a lot of problems and inconsistencies, to say the least, when it comes to the English language and how we communicate. If you'd like to stick around, there'll be some beverages and snacks served just a moment. Otherwise, take care. So long. Okay, so who would like some coffee and some muffins, right?